Good evening. My name is David Zilberman. I'm a professor at the University of California, Berkeley. And I am now making a presentation on designing supply chain to implement innovation. As you know, I am at Olga Robinson Chair at the University of California, Berkeley, and I won the Wolf Prize. And my research is on agriculture, environment, and economical supply chain. So what I will do, I'll give a motivation why we do it, speak about modeling, some of the implications of the work, conclusion and implication. Now, the basic idea behind the presentation is that in many cases, we live in an era where we operate with a lot of modern supply chain where production is done in location A, you grow flour in Europe, you process it in facility in one country, it goes to the flour market in Holland, and it's maybe exported to the United States. So how this supply chain work? What really lead to the development of supply chain? I will argue that every time that you have a radical innovation, it requires to start an industry. And with start an industry, you have to start a supply chain that includes multiple stages. And all these multiple stages basically are a new industry. And it's not enough to understand markets, you need to understand how supply chain operate and how they, at the end, they form the base for markets. So, the basic point is that we live in an era where there are a lot of innovations. Economic was formed when agriculture was the dominant industry, everything was competitive. But today we live in a world that every several years we have a new innovation. The internet, 30 or 40 years old, maximum, probably less. Computer, 80 years. Automobile, 100 years. The web, 20 years. Things are changing all the time. And even agriculture is changing. We have new technology, required technology. So because we have a new technology, as Theodore Schultz, the famous economist, said, we live in this equilibrium, and we have to realize how innovation are affecting the equilibrium. My work is inspired by the work of Schumpeter, that emphasized the notion of creative destruction, and by the note of Ronald Coase and Williamson that realized that firm and market are part of a bigger process. So, generally, the standard economics really start with market, but our starting point is that you have an innovator that wants to implement, an entrepreneur that wants to implement an innovation. It really requires several stages of production. Some of the question is, what is the scale of the operator? How big a chain of supermarket will be? Would they buy their product from an independent producer and contract it, or would they develop a vertically integrated organization? What will be the impact of market policies? So generally, innovators think globally, and they all the time change the world. Our traditional theory in economics was much more static and ignores innovation. So to some extent, we really need to be and understand innovation to have better economic policy and better understanding of the world. A key starting point is the notion of educational industrial complex. Educational industrial complex means that universities, academia, comes with innovation and the private sector implements. Scientists a lot of time are entrepreneurs. Even Sony started by a professor. There are three types of organizations: universities, startups, and major companies that are interact. It's even true in agriculture and everything else. That's the way that medical innovation works. Researchers come with, universities come with basic research. It moves to small companies, the discoveries and the patent move to startup, and then big companies expand and sell it. So we really need to understand how innovation works. Forever, countries that don't have this type of systems are not doing very well. In the US, in China, in Israel, in some European countries, you have this combination. Countries that don't have it are a problem, and therefore I am a big believer in the need to develop high-value universities and research centers. So to understand the concept, the way the system works, I have a very simple two-state supply chain. This supply chain includes two elements. Input production, or what we call feedstock production, which can be done either by farmers or within a company, and processing. So you have a company that owns the supply chain. They can either buy it from others, from farmers, or produce it themselves, and then we have vertical integration. So the supply chain includes a producers of feedstock, a biorefinery that refine it, and then you sell it. An example, biofuel. What happened with biofuel is that farmers produce the corn or sugarcane, companies buy it, refine it, and produce biofuel and sell it. Oil, regular oil. You have oil wells, and then you have refinery, and then you sell it to the final consumer. In many cases, you have new supply chains that are very creative. For example, people develop, a Danish entrepreneur developed a supply chain of flowers. They are grown in Kenya, they are processed in Kenya, they are shipped in Europe, and then they are distributed within Europe. So again, the feedstock is the flowers, the processing is shipping and selling, and then the key question, how big will be the supply chain? Will the entrepreneur own the flower farms, or would they buy from others? Now, what happened in Kenya is that it changed over time. In the beginning, the entrepreneurs basically developed a vertically integrated operation, developed farms and shipped it. They also used the farm they own as a demonstration farm, and then they start buying and contracting with other farmers so they can grow. A supermarket operates the same way. There are a lot of suppliers. Some of the products in the supermarket are the own brand of the supermarket, so it's vertical integration. Others are bought by market or contract, and then the supermarket process itself. If you look at Apple, the same thing. Apple computers, they're a company design computers. They buy part feedstock from many, many people. They have even people that basically integrate it, and what Apple does, they get the cell phone and then they market. Now, so to some extent, the supply chain design is an optimization problem. Whoever runs the supply chain has to decide about how we design it so it will be, that it will maximize the profit. So what do they take into account? They try to maximize the revenue, the amount of income they make, minus the cost of processing or production in-house or expenditure to suppliers, and decide about two decisions: how much to produce, how much to produce in-house, how much to buy from others. So the optimal condition is that the incremental revenue from a digital unit of output will be equal to the extra cost of processing plus the extra cost of production of the feedstock. So to some extent, if you are an entrepreneur that runs a supply chain, you have a lot of time, a monopoly power in the output market and a monopsony power in the input market. You basically have market power. You can make extra profit because you produce less than you produce under competition. And then you have to decide how much you produce yourself, how much you produce other, and then you do it in a way that the last unit, that at the last unit, you, the cost will be the same. So for example, if in general it will be more expensive to produce in-house, you will buy mostly from other, but you may buy some small quantity, you produce some quantity in-house that would be that expensive and also will give you knowledge about how the product is produced. So if the other thing that this model suggests, that your production cost may be increasing all over time, and then you will reduce, you will increase the scale of your operation, you sell more, you import more, you export more, and over time you may buy more from others and less produce in-house, like the example of the producer of flour. First, they really wanted to test the concept, so they have a relatively small operation, so they manage everything, but over time, they realized that they should concentrate in producing the processing the product, and someone else will produce the feedstock. So this is a very simple conceptual model that really explains that every time that you have an industry, you have really to think about the size, how much I buy myself, how much I produce, how much I produce myself, how much I buy from others, and this decision may change over time as you learn from your experience, the technology improves, the cost of production improves, you train more people to be your supplier. So a good model has to have this capacity to deal with dynamics, changes over time. It also has to take into account the fact that a lot of time you have credit and capital constraint. You have limitation on how much you can build, how much you can get from the bank to invest in the company. So all these constraints make it more and more difficult to develop an organization. And then you have a constraint that are associated with risk. So when you have risk, you may decide, okay, I would produce as much, but I will have a little bit of reserve, I have a little bit of storage. I may diversify the feedstock production, some I produce in-house, and some I buy from others. So I have the complete formulation how to do it, but that is a key point of all this analysis. Now, a key point of all this analysis is that when you have a new, when you have an innovating economy, innovation creates supply chain, and supply chain creates new market. So to some extent, markets are not something that is given. They are endogenous. They are in creating over time when you create new product and you create a supply chain. A lot of times the entrepreneur that creates a supply chain is a monopoly or in the output market or the monopsony in the input market. For example, Apple has an incredible market power on its supplier when they produce their output. And also Apple has a lot of power over the consumer. So Apple, in order to maximize profit, they produce much less than that they will produce if you have perfect competition, or which will be efficient from the market perspective. They produce less, they pay less to their supplier, and they charge more to the farmers. Now, the other thing that if you are in an innovative economy, is that once you develop a new supply chain, the product and the production system move across countries, and I think a little bit about it later. So Apple in the beginning started producing in Palo Alto, then they start selling in the US, then they start moving to Europe, and then they start moving to the rest of the world. And that's true with every other company. Walmart is an innovation. They thought about developing a large supermarket that take advantage of economic scale and will be big supply of everything. And they started in the South, in Arkansas, in the South, moved to the US, and then they moved to the world. So there are several key elements in the design of supply chain. How do you buy feedstock? One approach is to have vertical integration operation. For example, you can look at Intel subsidiary. This is a company that everything is produced in-house. Why do they do it? They do it because they want to control quality and they don't want that other people will know the trade secret. The other type of arrangement is contracting, contract farming, like the people in Africa that export flour to Europe. They have processing facility and mostly they buy from other producers. Apple, most of the production of Apple is contracting. They only design and sell. There is a mixed model that's called nucleus plasma, where a company has a big feedstock production and then buys from others. This is an example of Gallo wine, of a winery. Of big wineries, they have a lot of land that they control in order to understand how to grow wine better. And then they have a lot of supplier and then tell the supplier how to produce and they buy it and sell the wine. Then there are a lot of other systems where you really have, like in cocoa around the world, where you have a lot of small producers, you have middlemen, a lot of intermediaries that buy the input from the producer and sell it to processor. That is the case, for example, of chocolate around the world. Companies like Mars don't produce the cocoa themselves, they buy it from supplier, and then they produce the chocolate and sell it to consumer. Now, so what determines what structure would you have? First is money. Sometimes you don't have enough money to own all the supply chain, so you select the area where you have relative advantage and you will be unique. So if you have a lot of money, you may decide, okay, I will have a vertically integrated operation because then I don't really have to worry about intellectual property and other things. But if you don't have enough money, you concentrate in processing and someone else produce the feedstock. Another reason is diversification of risk. You a lot of time decide that I can, if I'm vertically integrated, something may happen to my facility. So some of my production are in-house and some is outside of the house. I also, you a lot of time will be worried about someone stealing your intellectual property. So in this case, you try to produce everything in-house. And in some countries, you may buy from a supplier. In other countries, you produce everything yourself. For example, some companies may try to have as much control, let's say in Russia, and in the US, they don't want to buy from other suppliers. And then there are trade regulations. In many countries, they will tell you, okay, if you want to have a facility here, you have to buy from local farmer or producing a certain percentage. So to some extent, the analysis is very dynamic and it depends on the situation. Now, up to now, I spoke about a very simple supply chain, feedstock processing. But it's a very, very, but in general, supply chain are more complex. They may have multi-stages. You may, for example, have production of feedstock, processing, and marketing. And then you have to decide about the multiple stages, what to do. One example is in agriculture is that you have agricultural input suppliers that provide the food. A lot of people that produce the feedstock, for example, people that produce meat. And then you have processing. And all these activities are affected by technologies. On one end, every time we have a new innovation, we have a new supply chain, as well as by government policy. One example, for example, is a company called Tyson, which is the biggest producer of cricket. Tyson, they buy the grain to feed the chicken and the pig from different companies. They provide it to a large number of farmers that are produce the chicken or they produce the feedstock, which is animals, and then Tyson produces it and sell it to consumers. Again, when they sell it to consumers, they may break it down to a lot of sub-product because they make money when they sell part of chicken rather than whole chicken. This is what people call a four-state supply chain, that you have basic input, processed feedstock, a feedstock, final product, and then you can have several byproducts or several marketing chains. Apple is one example. They basically buy the feedstock, the parts from many producers. They design the technology. Then Apple gets the computer or the iPhone from all the producers. And then they have to decide how much they sell it in Apple Store versus how much they sell it to other intermediaries. So in this case, you can really see that you have a system that is more diverse. So up to now, I look at it in a simple way, but the reality is that you have a dynamic framework. People think about the long run. They think about maximizing net present value. They think how the supply chain evolved. McDonald's started in a little place and then they move forward. So the movement and the dynamic of the supply chain are very, very important. Now, supply chain also adapt. It adapts to different conditions. You may decide to start in a certain place, the US, and design the product there. And then as you move to China or Vietnam or Taiwan, you will operate it, you will modify it. You make the US, you have one set of arrangements, vertical integration, but in other countries you have contracting. So moving supply chain and redesigning is a global challenge, and that's the way the world works. So when you have a new innovation, it starts new market, and the market structure evolves with the technology. So what are my conclusions from all this? First, that in a modern world, the educational industrial complex is the key for innovation. That you have a private supply chain, the university may produce the innovation, but the supply chain is private. So you need public-private partnership, good universities and good private sector. The structure of the supply chain is determined by the innovators and it's changing all the time. Markets, new markets are emerging all the time. The structure and magnitude is changing. And most importantly, there is a lot of monopoly power in the beginning that determines that allows supply chain to occur. So the big challenge of government is to allow sufficient monopoly, the supply chain will start, but at the same time regulate against exploitation. So what does it mean? We need to understand when we look in developing countries, that when we look in food, we need to understand all the production below the farm gate. When you look at any other industry, we need to understand how all the starts, all the elements of the system are operated. We need to invest in data, infrastructure, and the human capital that needed for everything, from the research to the last stage. We cannot have only agricultural policy, we need to have agri-food policy. We need to have data policy rather than rather than computer policy. An international organization needs to understand how supply chain operate and their operation. So when we analyze trade, we need to realize how important infrastructure are. growth, knowledge, human capital, innovations, and nations need to realize that if they want to have innovation, they need both infrastructure, they need both intellectual property protection, good legal system, as well as very good university. So, to some extent, the key element in this lecture is to develop a new framework that shows you how everything related and how new innovation changed industry and the industry evolved over time. Thank you for the pleasure to speak with you. Bye-bye.